place that I've never been. Take it or leave it, I'm making up my mind.
Tonight we're dancing free. Let the whole world come around and see. I've got no reason to hold it all inside. The sun is going down on the west side swing. Warming up a place that I've never been. Look around and see who's on your side. I'm ready to ride.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to the closing night of the 12th annual ReelAbilities Film Festival. My name is Rabbi Joy Levitt, and I'm the executive director of the Marlene Meyerson JCC Manhattan. First, let me offer our prayers to all of you who are ill or caring for a loved one who is ill. We all know how personal this has become, joining us even more closely as a community. I want to thank you for weaning yourselves off Netflix. I know how hard that has been, and we very much appreciate seeing thousands of you participate in dozens of films, conversations, and panels. It has filled us with hope for a better tomorrow. Although we could not be together in person, many of us have felt that we were literally in this together, and that felt really terrific. ReelAbility exists in part because there are voices that need to be amplified. In these challenging times, the disability community needs to be heard all the more. We are proud to say that this was our most accessible festival ever. For years, thanks to support from our partners, we have been providing captions, audio description, ASL, and live CART captions. We've also partnered with venues throughout New York to bring the films to dozens of communities, which also is a form of accessibility. But being virtual allowed us to be in every home for every event, allowing all of us to participate from our living rooms. I want to acknowledge those who helped make our festival so accessible: Michelle Spitz, Women of Her Word, Adapt Community Network, DTCC, NBC Universal, Omnicom, and Pfizer. These films will now travel through our international program to dozens more cities and through our Real Ed program into schools and corporate offices to share our mission of changing perceptions and creating fuller inclusion. I want to thank all of our partners and supporters without whom this festival would not exist. And you can see the link on the right to see all of those partners. Thank you to everyone who donated during the festival. Your generosity has kept us feeling very inspired and supported. Please continue to support us throughout the year to ensure that we can continue to build on our success. You can donate or become a sponsor on our website. I do want to highlight a few individuals who work tirelessly to make this festival possible. To our steadfast and amazing co-chairs, Michelle Fagg and Lynn Bartner-Wiesel, and to the one and only chair of the Advisory Council, Jordana Manzano. Together with our former co-chair Heidi Lorensky, these extraordinary women will be honored at the JCC benefit, now rescheduled for the fall. Thanks to our dedicated film selection committee who combed through the hundreds of films and advisory committee who helps us in so many ways. And of course, the festival team that has made this festival happen and then turned it virtual in less than 3 weeks. I'm getting teary just thinking about their work. The amazing AV team, Matt Temkin and Sam Brunswick, who have gone above and beyond to make all of this possible with even more technology. The festival team, Yara Kedem, the Associate Director for ReelAbilities and the ReelAbilities International Director, Morgan Maggett, our Program Manager, Shamika Anglin the film administrative associate, our PR and publicist, Allison Rosen and Ishul Baghdadi, April Lowe, our production manager, Brianne Matloff, the senior director of development, Melissa Reagan, the director of institutional giving, Lola Denizio, our partnership coordinator. Betlana Dubkova, our social media, Jessica Epstein, and the design and marketing team. And of course, my friend, Anita Altman, the co-founder of ReelAbilities, who never gives up when fighting for a cause. There is no better teammate than having Anita on our side. And the one and only Isaac Zablocki, the festival founder and director. Our amazing interpreter, Brandonian Kazen Maddox, and card provider, Lauren Schechter. And a huge thank you to all our volunteers and interns. It's now my honor to turn things over to Isaac Zablocki, the director and co-founder of ReelAbilities.
Thank you so much. I'm taking a moment because Victor Calisi, our commissioner, the commissioner for Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities, thank you so much, Joy. He's texting me saying that he can't get on the Zoom.
Oh.
How can I make a speech while he's, I've set it up, he's hopefully got it. So thank you very much. And now I could get back to what's at hand. This has been an amazing week, and I really want to start by thanking, of course, everyone who made this possible, and thank you, Joy, for making me cry too. But also to our audiences who have been such an amazing and engaging part of this festival this week. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you all for thanking us constantly. We need the reassurance. And this was really a unique year for ReelAbilities, and although we always have guests from around the world, something, because we're going through something universally right now, this quarantine is universal. It allowed us, first of all, I mean, no directors had any excuse that they were doing anything else. They couldn't go anywhere. None of them were on vacation. But we all really felt unified with something this week. And I think it's going to be remembered as a very special year. I want to thank again the Marlene Meyerson JCC Manhattan Leadership Board and staff who have been so supportive, especially in these times. And I know the JCC remains committed to championing diversity and inclusion, and now more than ever. There's no one way to be a person with a disability, and this festival presents the human stories. Human is our word for the evening. You'll be hearing it a lot, spelled in different ways though. Each unique and as engaging as the other, these films and stories make up a colorful mosaic of our world. And everyone was welcome this week. So we're really proud to present these films. I've also been saying for a while, that there's a revolution going on. We were in the midst of it. This year has been by far a year where we received more applications for films, of worthy films, than ever before. We're seeing it in the mainstream. Our films are going there. We are getting close to our goal. We hope that someday ReelAbilities will be obsolete. And don't worry, we won't start. We still have a long stop. We still have a long way to go. But it's really amazing to see how much more inclusivity there is as far as representation, authentic representation of people with disabilities in the mainstream. Though one thing that I was reminded this week, as we're all stuck with our Netflix and whatever other movies we're catching up on, the ReelAbilities movies are nothing like Hollywood movies. They are a unique genre that really tells stories of people with disabilities like no other. And they're fantastic. I always say that the authenticity actually raises the quality of these films and makes them just more sincere and more real and more human. There we go again with the human. Our closing night right now, we have, following our conversation, we're gonna have at 8:30 p.m. The film Bedlam. We hope you're joining us for that. It examines mental health in America, a topic that is so, so crucial right now. But now we are honored to have here tonight a truly living legend, Judith Heumann. Judy, thank you so much. Let's give a round of applause. How many of you have seen Crip Camp already? just to take a look around and see people's hands up in the air. When you're done with ReelAbilities, then you're permitted to go back to Netflix, and then definitely be watching Crip Camp. And at the same time, you should be reading Judith Heumann's book, an unrepentant memoir of disability rights activist. Being Human is the title, spelled human like her name. She is a disability rights activist. She is the most impactful disability rights activist in American history, which has impacted the entire world. We have many boxes of her new book waiting at the JCC that's been closed, and we haven't been able to access them, but luckily you'll be able to pre-order them on Amazon. It's a story of fighting to belong in a world that wasn't built for all of us, and one woman's activism from the streets of Brooklyn, she's representing, that's nice, and San Francisco, to inside the halls of Washington. Also in 2010, and this is an important note, Heumann became the special advisor of disability rights for the US State Department appointed by President Barack Obama, the good days. And of course, you'll all know her as one of the key figures highlighted in the Sundance opening night film. This is the revolution we're talking about, which is now on Netflix, Crip Camp. Let's watch a quick clip from that film, Crip Camp.
A school district was allowed to designate one school as the school that children with disabilities and students with disabilities could go to. Well, what's that? That's separate but equal.
The harassment, the lack of equity that has been provided for disabled individuals, and that now is even being discussed by the administration, is so intolerable that I can't quite put it into words. I can tell you that every time you raise issues of separate but equal, the outrage of disabled individuals across this country is going to continue. It is going to be ignited. There will be more takeovers of buildings. Until finally, maybe you begin to understand our position.
Thank you for Netflix for allowing us to show that clip and making sure we all knew it was part of Netflix PR. I'm gonna hand things over now. Just a quick reminder to everyone, if you wanna ask questions, please ask questions using the chat option on the back and we'll cue you in to ask questions. But first I'm gonna hand things over to not only our number one moderator, but our number one fan. He has been one of the people who has inspired the mission of this festival, the kinds of films you see. He's the person to go to about anything film related, anything advocacy related. He is just an amazing person, and we're glad to have you here, Lawrence Carter Long, in conversation with Judith Heumann. Over to you.
Thank you, Yitzi, and thank you for that wonderful, wonderful introduction. It's a pleasure to be here with you at Closing Night of ReelAbilities. I can't believe how much we've grown in the last 12 years and how this continues to grow. And I'm thrilled that I'm able to be celebrating with you here tonight. And nothing gives me greater pleasure than to be having this conversation tonight with an activist that you've seen on Crip Camp. Hopefully you're reading Being Heumann, an unrepentant memoir of a disability rights activist, and a person who's become a personal friend of mine in the last few years. And I'm not just saying that. Judy Heumann. Judy, welcome aboard.
Thank you very much.
Look
at his clothing. I love your jacket.
I just want to say, I don't wear this all the time, but for ReelAbilities and for you, Judy, you know, I had to break it out of my
closet. I love it. And it
is a celebration. And I interesting seeing that clip. To those who haven't seen the clip before, or maybe who have, I was waiting. It was sort of building up to that moment when you, with that combination of anger, I think, and frustration, tell him that you'd appreciate it if he quit shaking his head, and because he didn't know what you're talking about. You want to talk a little bit about that moment that we saw the clip from here?
Yeah, so to put it in the context, this was during the takeover of the Health Education and Welfare Building in San Francisco in 1977. The film will describe more detail about that particular action and many other things. And we were able to get Congressman George Miller and Congressman Burton to come into the building and hold informal hearings. And they were able to get someone from the Carter administration to come to those hearings. And so the gentleman that was there was a civil servant. And let's just say, in retrospect, I felt really bad for the sucker because, you know, he was there representing the administration and why they had thus far failed to sign the 504 regulations, which is why there were demonstrations in like 10 or 11 cities. And the Bay Area, which was Congressman Burton's district, San Francisco, was where 150 people had taken over the federal building. And so people were really tired. The demonstrations were 28 days, but this was probably within, I don't remember, the first 7 to 10 days of the hearing, of the takeover. So when you watch the film, or Dredith has something called The Power of 504, which you can get on YouTube, and it's just focusing on the demonstrations. That it was a very powerful hearing. And for me at that point, I was really tired because we'd been working so long. And when this guy kept shaking his head, I kind of lost it.
And that's kind of an iconic moment in disability rights history here in around the world and here in the United States. And to those of you that you can find that clip, a deeper dive, 18 minutes, The Power of 504, on the YouTube page of Dredf, where I work as the communications director. That's DREDF. So you can do a search for that. That's The Power of 504, and it can tell you more.
You can also look at something called Drunk History.
And yes, absolutely. Check out Drunk History, where Ali Stroker portrays Judy Heumann. It's the clips are on YouTube too. Like, I can't do it justice. Just search that out and seek it out. To Ali, who has starred on Broadway in Oklahoma and was in Spring Awakening, does a fantastic job. I want to know where they got those glasses, Judy.
I don't know, but they were the same ones that I was wearing that you saw on the short.
Yeah, so that whoever the props person was for that clip really did their job. Bravo. Yep. So before we go to 504 and before we talk about the sit-in, I'd like to go back to the beginning, close to the beginning. You grew up there in Brooklyn, New York. Why don't you talk a little bit about just what your life was like before that sort of that revelation or that realization that you'll read from in just a minute. And give it some context as to why that moment was so important and why you felt compelled to write about it in your book so many decades later.
So I grew up in Brooklyn, New York. I'm Jewish, and my parents came over from Germany when they were 12 and 14 years old. And I guess the setting is their parents died in concentration camps, and my dad served in the Marines, and my mom did volunteer work, working with one of the operations to help keep things going in the United States. They got married, and you know, like many other immigrants, Jewish immigrants and others, they fully anticipated that they would get married, have a family, and just move forward. So they did. They got married. They bought a little house in Brooklyn. My father was a butcher. He had a small store with his brother. everybody on my father's side of the family that came from Germany. They were all butchers. And then I had polio when I was 18 months old. My mother was pregnant with my brother. She was 8 months pregnant when I had polio. And so, you know, they had to make important decisions. It was suggested by a doctor at one point that I be put in an institution. They said no. And then, you know, they kind of had to make it up as they went along, which is true for, you know, many of the parents who have been involved with ReelAbility and others watching ReelAbility programs, movies. The bottom line is my parents became advocates because I was denied the right to go to school because I couldn't walk and was considered a fire hazard. Finally did start going to school in the, when I was 9 years old, but could only get into special education classes. I was the first kid from my special ed classes to actually go to high school. My mother and other mothers had organized to demand that the Board of Ed set up schools so those of us who used wheelchairs wouldn't have to go back onto home instruction. So the part in the book that I'm gonna read for a couple of minutes is really relating to when I kind of began to realize that I was different, because I grew up in a neighborhood where it was this, you know, for Brooklyn, it was still a very small neighborhood. There were no apartment buildings on our block. And it was a relatively new neighborhood where families had kids all about the same age. And on the block, I really didn't experience discrimination from the people in the neighborhood. I had to deal with issues of steps and things like that. But so you want me to read it now?
Yeah, why don't you read that now? And you were, this is a little bit before then, you were about 7 or 8, you said, is that right?
Yes, yeah, so I think it was a beautiful sunny day, but it might have been cloudy. I don't remember. What I do remember was being caught up in my conversation with Arlene as she pushed me in my wheelchair, talking about what we were going to buy at the candy store or what we wanted to do later that day. We were pleased to be walking around the corner to buy sweets in front of Dr. Nagler's brick house, which I knew was Dr. Nagler's house because I'd been there with my mother for her doctor appointments. We paused across the street. Arlene turned me around to lower my wheelchair off the curb, pushed me across the street, and then once we reached the other side, she put her foot on the metal bar on the back of my chair, tipped me and the chair back, and lifted my chair onto the sidewalk. As we did this, a few kids came toward us from the opposite direction. They were walking slowly down the street. As they passed, Arlene shifted my wheelchair to the side to make room for them. We didn't know them and didn't pay much attention, engrossed as we were in our conversation. So I was surprised when one of the kids turned suddenly to look at me. He stood in front of me, staring down at me in my wheelchair. "Are you sick?" he asked me loudly. I stared at him, not understanding. "What? Are you sick?" he repeated insistently. His voice boomed. I shook my head, trying to clear the words away. I still was confused, but couldn't speak. "Are you sick?" he asked, slowing the words down as if I were a toddler. The world went silent as the words reverberated in my head. I couldn't hear anything except those words. "Are you sick? Sick, 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 sick." I shrank down, frozen with confusion, wanting to cover myself up with something, anything to hide from the question, the boy's insistent eyes on me. "Are you sick?" he asked insistently, almost shouting. Suddenly, I became aware of Dr. Nagler's house, and my face turned a cringing deep red. "Does he think I'm going to the doctor?" "But he's not my doctor," I thought fiercely. I fought back tears. I couldn't, wouldn't cry in front of everyone. I wasn't sick. It made no sense. I knew I wasn't. But then, why was he asking me that? I became uncertain of myself. Was I sick? I saw myself through his eyes, and the light around me shifted. Shadows emerged from the corners of my mind, previously submerged words, thoughts, and half-heard conversations tumbled into the glare of a spotlight. In a blinding flash, everything in my life made a perverse kind of sense. I couldn't go to this school. I couldn't go to that school. I couldn't do this. I couldn't do that. I couldn't walk up the stairs. I couldn't open doors. I couldn't even cross the street. I was different. But I'd always known that. It wasn't that. It was the world and how it saw me. The world thought I was sick. Sick people stayed home in bed. They didn't go out to play or go to school. They weren't expected to go outside, to be a part of things, to be a part of the world. I wasn't expected to be a part of the world. Abruptly, I knew this to be true, as if the knowledge had already existed for years throughout my entire body. I felt nauseatingly humiliated at the idea that everyone else had known this but me. Had they kept it from me? The embarrassment settled in as a cold ball deep in my stomach, where I could feel it spreading into my limbs. Was it sunny or cloudy? I don't know. I remember Arlene was pushing me. We were going to the store to buy candy, and we were chatting, and I was a butterfly becoming a caterpillar.
Right, and that moment of realization, right? Sort of going backwards. Yeah, let's give everybody, give it up, and wherever you're at. It was a shock to the system, right? That it was that revelation, that realization, not of how you felt about yourself, but how the rest of the world perceived you to be, imagined you to be. From there, there was a period of time, of course, before you went to Camp Jened. Did those glaring sort of observations or those assumptions that people made, come into focus there? Did they start to influence kind of how you viewed yourself in the world and what your own expectations were for yourself beyond that point?
So for those of you who've seen Crip Camp, you know that it focuses on a camp called Camp Jened, which was a camp for disabled people. At one point it was for youth, teenagers, and adults. And over the years, because of various things, it narrowed its population. I had originally gone to a camp called Camp Oakhurst, which was in New Jersey, run by the Jewish Federation. And Camp Jened was also run by a family that was Jewish. And I wanna put a little of this in context. I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and we look at Camp Jened and other camps for disabled individuals, not recognizing that the reason why those camps were created was because disabled kids were basically not allowed into regular camps. My brothers both went to camp. They went to something called Camp Wellmet, which was another Jewish camp. And, it was today, you can call it like a specialized camp, but those camps were really there to help support the cultural development of people and to really allow people, in this case, to look at themselves as Jews and learn about culture and religion and music and food, etc. The camps for disabled kids were really not in any way viewed as similar kinds of programs. They were.
What do you think they were geared for? What was the purpose?
I think the purpose was to make sure that families could send their kids. If families sent their kids to camp and they had a disabled kid, that there was a camp that these kids could go to. And they were well-run camps, and there was a lot of fun and activities that went on there. But there was no conscious attempt for any kind of discussions around culture. But And it wasn't called culture at that point at all. But I think what was important about Jeanette and other camps and even the special education classes that I went to in some way is that it was the first time for many of us that we were together with other disabled people, and specifically at camps. And Jeanette, we were there for 4 to 8 weeks. It really allowed us to have fun, but it also allowed us to begin to explore issues going on in our lives. For example, we were beginning to recognize as teenagers that there were expectations for our siblings. Go to school, you want to get through the American dream, go to school, study hard, do what you need to do, and the doors will open. But that was clearly not going to be the case for those of us with disabilities. And what was going on at the same time was the civil rights movement was evolving. We saw other groups fighting for their rights. So it really, and for many of us who went to camp for multiple years and spoke to each other and saw each other during the year. So it was not only a bonding of friendship, but it was really beginning to test our strength and our vision. You know, we would have discussions about what kinds of jobs are we gonna have, because we didn't know a lot of disabled people that were working, and the ones that were working were in very narrow fields. And we were talking about how the city was so inaccessible and how as teenagers, we were beginning no longer to be able to really associate with our neighbors who were beginning to go on buses and go to other places for parties and things. So I think camp was really a very important part of our lives. And while on the one hand, people may look at this as a segregated environment, it was no more segregated than other specific camps. And it really was a way for us to begin to exert ourselves, gain our own voice, speak up and out in a way that would likely not have happened if we would have had to stay with our families in our homes all summer.
Yeah, and you know, you think about the context of this, like in the segment that you read from the book, you know, you had your person there who had to tip the wheelchair back and kind of pop you over the curb, right? And I remember that.
This was in the 50s. There were no motorized wheelchairs.
Right. So you're being pushed, and you have to do that physics experiment every time you're crossing the street, right? Yeah. And that, unlike, let's say, maybe many communities of color or from different ethnic backgrounds, you know, most folks with disabilities, you didn't grow up in a family that had other people with disabilities, right? So the only way that you could develop that sense of solidarity or community, where you understood that the experiences that you had with the weird looks or the strange questions on the street, would be when you could all of a sudden relate that and share that with somebody else who had a similar experience.
Yes, exactly.
And that happened not because they wanted to facilitate that, but because the camps were trying to build that culture, but it was a function of the situation, of not by design, but almost by accident. It grew out of the circumstances.
I want to also say that, you know, when you look at the film, Crip Camp, you'll see that I was at that point 21 or 22 years old, and many of the kids, Jimmy LeBrec, who's one of the directors of the film and really the originator of the idea, he is a disabled man who had spina bifida, so from birth, but he went to regular schools. But when he came to camp, it was, I think, an eye-opening experience in many ways. One is, you'll see in the film, he's a very good-looking young guy. But in the non-disabled world, he wasn't sought after.
Right, wasn't given a second glance, not even a first glance.
No.
Right.
But, you know, within a very short time, he had a girlfriend at camp, and it's really funny in the way it's in the movie. And all these different things were going on. And so we really had an opportunity as equals, as disabled people who were teenagers. And I think, as you're saying, you know, Lawrence, this was nothing that other people saw consciously as a place to help disabled people gain their identity. But not now, but I think people are having discussions about, do we want to look at creating something which is not going to be quote unquote labeled as segregated environment, but more as cultural opportunities for disabled people to be able to come together and really have fun, but also be able to really have some serious discussions, which of course we did, about how we felt as disabled people not being equal in our communities. It was a place, as you were saying, that because frequently most people didn't have other disabled people in their families, even though parents were loving and supportive and fighting for us, they still, on a very fundamental level, did not really get some of the day-to-day experiences that we had. And being able to be together in the summer, but also friends that you could talk to during the year, was really helpful and continues to be helpful.
Yeah, one of the most striking parts of Crip Camp, I think, was this remarkable footage by the People's Video Theater, where they capture those conversations, right? They film the campers talking among themselves about issues like the privilege of privacy, you know, that people had grown up their entire lives and never really had a moment to themselves. And you probably wouldn't even have a chance to stop and reflect about that if you didn't come into contact with other disabled campers, right? Because that would just be your normal. I'm curious to know, and there, you know, there wasn't time in Crip Camp to talk about this, but we've got the time here, we make the rules. What was it in terms of that kind of sense of solidarity and community that made you want to go from being a camper at a place like Jened and to being a counselor? Why did you feel that that was an important role for you to take?
So actually, I was exactly a counselor. I was kind of in administration. And I had graduated from college, and it was 1971. So I had sued the Board of Education and had gotten my job. It was the end of my first year of teaching. And as I recall, they called me and asked me.
And we should let people know, if they haven't read the book yet, that you had to sue the was it the state of New York to become a teacher?
No, New York City Board of Education.
New York City Board of Education. Right. And they literally told you that you couldn't be a teacher. Well, I'll let you reveal that. What was the reason?
So I was failed on my medical exam because of paralysis of both lower extremities, sequelae of poliomyelitis. So I can acknowledge I did not know what sequelae meant. So I looked it up, I presumed what it meant, and it meant because of. So I'd been denied my license because I couldn't walk. And I think that was a very pivotal time in my life because I had wanted to be a teacher. I had taken the courses that I needed at that time. There was the baby boom era. I didn't major in education because my friends with disabilities said, don't major in education. The Department of Rehabilitation will never support you because you can't show them a person who became a teacher using a wheelchair. So I did everything that I could to help prepare. And I ultimately decided I would pursue this. I took written exam, the oral exam, the medical exam, all given in inaccessible buildings because, again, there was no 504, there was no Americans with Disabilities Act. I passed my oral, I passed my written, and there I was failing my medical exam, which I had presumed was going to happen. And I didn't know.
There was a physical ed requirement, is that right?
No, you had to take a medical exam.
A medical exam.
I went for my medical exam. And you can read it in the book, but it was kind of one of the most outrageous experiences I ever had. Bottom line is, I was denied my license and I had to make a decision as to whether or not I would sue, but I had no lawyers. And then one day, there was an article in the New York Times about my being denied my license. And the next day, there was an op-ed in the New York Times, or editorial, sorry, an editorial in the New York Times supporting my becoming a teacher. And I got a call from a lawyer named Roy Lucas, who was calling me to interview me for a book he was writing. And I thought he sounded really nice and I'd be brave enough to ask him if he would represent me. And so he plus another attorney represented me pro bono. And we got the judge, was the first African-American woman serving on the federal bench in the New York region. And when we went to court, she basically told the Board of Ed she thoroughly encouraged them to give me another medical exam. So ultimately they did, and the Board of Ed settled out of court, but the New York State Legislature passed a law allowing wheelchair users, and actually there was a case that I didn't know about at the time of a blind man who was also denied a license, removing restrictions that had been put on at one point. So it was a very important time in my life. And honestly, I think the combination of Camp Jened and Camp Oakers, the friends that I've made over the years who had disabilities, we'd started a group called Disabled in Action at that time as a result of my being denied my license. And all of those parts together really enabled me to move forward the lawsuit, because I never viewed the lawsuit totally as my lawsuit. It was an opportunity, yes, to talk about a specific example of discrimination in the area of teaching, but it really allowed more of us with disabilities through Disabled in Action, other groups, to really begin to speak up about this. I want to say, you know, one other important part of what was going on then is the Jerry Lewis telethon and the United Cerebral Palsy telethons, which were very big at that time.
And would it be fair to say that, you know, people now, we've got 500 channels and we can change the channel and find all these different various streaming services, but really at that point in time, in terms of the media, almost the only time you saw a disabled person was during one of those telethons, right? And the message was basically, well, you don't want to end up like this kid, do you? So let us find a cure.
I mean, there were some movies out there that were also had a disabled character, but you know, oh my God, the Sidney Poitier movie.
Patch of Blue.
You know, so the woman, the girl there is blind. And if you remember or not, there is a scene in that movie where she is not blind and she is dancing as a non-blind person. So the messages that we were getting when they were there were really A, non-disabled people playing roles of disabled people, which continues to go on today, and B, the belief that if you had a disability, you didn't want to have that disability. And so Patchwork Blue, a perfect example of how this, you know, young woman didn't want to be blind.
Right, the disability was only really regarded or thought of in the context of not wanting to be disabled.
Right, soap operas where people got cured and miraculously started walking, you know, or were dead and came to life, you know, whatever.
Yeah, and I want to talk a little bit, we're going to go to audience questions in just a minute, but I wanted to give you a moment, if you wanted to, you know, we talked a little bit about the 504 sit-ins, and that was, you know, still remains the longest occupation, nonviolent occupation of a federal building in the United States. And that advocacy career, that moment in time sort of catapulted you to be one of the founders of the first Center for Independent Living here in Berkeley. And from there, I just wanted to talk a little bit about your work at the State Department and with the Obamas, and how work with something like, you know, the foundation that we created with the Americans with Disabilities Act in 1990 became the template for the CRPD. So I wanted to give you a chance to talk about your international work, if you would.
Yeah, so let me say that in the 1970s, there was not only the development of the disability rights movement in the US, not that there hadn't been a disability movement previously, but I think we have to put it in the context of television, advanced technology, airplane travel, all kinds of things were beginning to happen. And in many countries around the world, there were emerging disability rights movements. And so in the 70s, after Center for Independent Living was started, we started having some people, not only from in the United States, to come visit CIL, you know, a disabled run, non-residential advocacy organization that at its time was considered to be radical. And as someone said to me one day, we were all communists who were not appreciative of what the system had done for us. But the goal was
just for people who may not know, the goal was to provide the tools and the resources that you folks would need to live on their own independently in the community.
But one of the big parts of it, we were doing that because traditional services like housing services and transportation, et cetera, were excluding disabled people. So the real premise of Centers for Independent Living were, and today still are, as advocacy organizations that are intended to be working on legislation and policy at local, county, state, and federal levels, to in fact change policies and laws and to help disabled people, support disabled people in becoming leaders of their own life. And so that was emerging. And you see this in the 70s and 80s through today. And there's something called the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which began to be developed at the United Nations in about 2002. And it was being modeled on the Americans with Disabilities Act. And it was being advanced because the disability community was saying there are many different treaties that the United Nations has ratified in areas for children and women and many others, but disability is either completely not included in any of those other treaties or so minimally included that it's not advancing our rights. And so over a five-year period of time, you kind of saw in a very similar way, but on an international level, that disabled people began to organize. They came to the UN, there was a formal system set in motion. And over that five-year period of time, there were hundreds of disabled people that were coming and developing what's now called the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Now, why is that relevant in the United States today? It's relevant in the United States today because when the Obama administration came in, they wanted to ratify the CRPD. But in order for ratification to happen in the US, two-thirds of the Senate has to vote for that. And so we worked really hard. The Bush administration had done nothing on it. We were able to get President Obama to sign it. And then we worked really hard to get the Senate to vote for ratification, which they refused to do. It was, the Senate became controlled by the Republicans, and we had like six or seven Republicans supporting it, but we couldn't get to the number that we needed.
And this was,
in spite of the fact that Senator Dole, a disabled Republican, had worked and still is actually at the age of 93 or 94, working tirelessly for this. When we look at where we are today with the pandemic going on, our failure to have ratified this treaty really can be seen around the world because we're not at the tables fighting for the inclusion of disability in prevention and intervention work. And so, you know, my hope is we have an administration change this fall and can get this back on the table.
Yeah, and it's important to note that laws like the Americans with Disabilities Act were passed during a Republican administration.
Yeah.
That while Democrats may have done the heavy lifting a lot of times. Disability is for most of sort of political history, been a big bipartisan issue, that it would get the support of Republicans and Democrats. So not getting that bipartisan support is a relatively recent phenomenon.
Yes.
Yeah. I want to make sure we get some time for your audience and the people watching at home and listening at home. So I have your first live question. If you want to switch to speaker view. And this question is from Chandra Benito. Chandra, when you're ready, the floor is yours.
Thank you. This is Chandra from Salt Lake City. So great to see your beautiful face.
Chandra.
So great to see you guys. My question for you is, so with COVID-19, how do you think this changes what we need to be doing moving forward as it relates to disability rights activism?
Thank you. It's a great question. And first of all, I think it's very important that Centers for Independent Living and many other organizations are right now really in the middle of these discussions as legislation is being passed at the federal level and state levels and being implemented. The fact that, you know, we're in a totally different position than we were, for example, in the 70s or 80s, where we weren't really organized. Now we're not yet as organized as we need to be, but we have groups like the National Council on Independent Living and the American Association of People with Disabilities, plus groups like the ARC and other national groups, the for and of disability groups, are really much more prominently being seen. My concern is not only the immediate moment and what we need to do to ensure that if someone with a disability in fact contracts the virus, that we are not treated differently than others, that our lives are not seen as being of less value. But the other concern that I have is there's a major change going on economically. The number of people who are unemployed, the repercussions for the country and the world are going to be quite stark. And we really don't know yet how we're going to be impacted. So I think, you know, we're really going as a disability community, as allies for us within the disability community, not only to be at the table, but to be really aggressive. Because so many people are being laid off from their jobs. And we need to make sure that as those jobs come back, that disabled people are going to be able to not only assume positions they had before, but will be able to get other jobs. And I think we have to recommend, and I think the fact that the film at 8:30 is going to be focusing on issues around mental health, we have to realize that there's going to be a larger group of individuals who may well have PTSD as a result of this. And as a disability community ourselves, we're really going to need to be able to address and learn more about how we can continue to be and become a stronger cross-disability community, disability and by race, et cetera.
I think it's important to note also that a lot of the things people with disabilities have been asking for, fighting for, suing for a very long time, we're now doing because of necessity, because non-disabled people are worried that they're going to get sick, right? But because of this, we now know that it's possible. And I hope that it's something that we can continue forward both here in the United States and around the world and remember those lessons that disabled folks have been telling us about for a really long time. I want to go to the second question here live.
Let me just say one thing. Sure. There's an international group called the International Disability Alliance, and on an international level, they're also one of the groups doing some really important work on COVID-19.
Right. Yeah. So can you give the name of that group again, Judy?
International Disability Alliance, IDA.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you. Second question, I want to go to Robert Klein. Robert, when you're ready.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay.
Go for it.
One thing that resonated with me especially this evening, was the impact that one super dynamic person such as Judith can have such a singular influence, or did have such a singular influence on legislative and activist agendas. And I think Sir Philip Craven embodied that kind of leadership in that movie, I forget, Positive All the Way. And certainly Judith did in Knock the Ball Out of the Court and knock Mr. Califano out of the court in Crip Camp. So the question that I raise is a two-part question. The first is, will this kind of progress necessarily require the super dynamic persistence of people like Sir Philip and Judith, or can't we all come together, if you will, both disabled and non-disabled, to bring this community together, the entire community, disabled and non-disabled, towards these goals rather than a singular thing? And the second would be, can't we, the CARES 2 Act is about to be enacted in a couple of weeks or a month. And that act lacks any, Judith was just referring to this, it lacks any real, the kind of benefits that people with disabilities deserve. And that includes in particular caregivers, babysitters, all the other expenses that are not even referenced. Is there anything that we can do to apply pressure on Congress? Thank you.
Okay, so that's my dissertation. No, let me just say a couple things. First of all, it's really important to understand that everything that I've been involved with has been the result of working with not only other disabled activists, some which are extroverted like me, some whom are more introverted, but none of this would have happened without many, many hundreds and thousands of people being involved. And if you look at work that I've also been involved with, for example, the demonstrations in California, we also worked regularly with other civil rights groups that were really not disability focused, because we supported them. And then when it came time to deal with the 504 regulation, the demonstrations, they were supporting us. And I think what we've seen over the last 30, 40 years is a slow development of other allies, Leadership Conference on Civil Rights, women's organizations, Latino groups, et cetera. I fully believe not to the degree that they should be, but much more than they were 30, 40 years ago, 20 years ago. So I think it's aspirational that we need to be working more collaboratively together. And at times like this, I think we really are seeing that people are understanding that we need to support each other, because when one group is having problems, the other group is having problems. So Robert, I think we are moving forward in that vein, but I ultimately also think it really has to start at the local level. So whatever groups that you're working with, whether they're disability groups who need to be working with non-disability groups, or non-disability groups that need to be integrating disability into their work, people need, and one thing I think is very important about the film and my book and other people's books, is really getting a much more clear understanding about what are the barriers that we face and what is it that we're talking to society about, and how in some very real way non-disabled people have to get over their fear of acquiring a disability. In order, you know, when looking at like the CARES Act, for example, we need people really to understand what personal assistance is about and how, you know, many people are using personal assistance, whether it's their family members or friends who are not getting paid to do this work. But the need for us to have more people who can be hired to do this work, make personal assistance something which is not considered to be a negative job, but rather a valued job in many ways, like teachers. You know, people who help us be able to move about in our homes, in our communities, should be valued people, not devalued people. And so, you know, for me, it's everyone needs to speak up. We need to educate non-disabled people who will acquire disabilities about how they would be able to stay in their home and stay out of nursing homes if there were more supports in the community. We need to make these programs more available. Long-term care insurance, for example, I'm not eligible for it. My husband wasn't eligible for it. If you were a federal employee, which I was, with the level of disability I had, you could not get long-term care insurance, even though through the federal government. I'm an AARP member, I got rejected. So there's a new discussion that needs to happen. What is personal assistance? How does it enable us to keep our integrity and live in the community? And it needs to be something which is taken out from behind the scenes and move forward. People need to go to the bathroom, they need to get showered, they need to empty their leg bag, they need to help need help with feeding and various other things. And we need to no longer be embarrassed about that. We need to make people understand they do it, we may need help to do it, and it should be supported financially.
Right, and I think one of the things that Crib Camp shows, right, is that until we sort of model that, until we show that, until we present that, other people aren't gonna recognize that or realize that even themselves. And so it takes those people that are willing to or able to to go forward and to say that first, so that other people can realize, oh wait, I'm in that company, I'm with those folks. I need to join in. I am not alone in this. I know that groups like DREDF.org, AAPD, other groups, the ARC, Bazelon, are you know, doing a lot of work around COVID-19, and you know, there are hashtags out there like We Are Essential, that people can go on Twitter and follow and get that information. DREDF has it on our website, that you could use in whatever state you're in. We wrote a letter to the governor of California with the idea that it could be a template for other states. So people really need to make use of that information.
And let me take it on a very basic level, exactly what Lawrence is saying. Your city council member, your county board of supervisor member, your state legislator, senate and assembly, your congressmen, your senators need to hear stories. It needs to be specific. And actually, Senator Casey's sent out a notice today, and I'll send it to Izzy, asking for people to tell their stories so that people, members of Congress, understand. We need to be able to tell our stories, which is really what ReelAbility is all about, right? People telling our stories. And so I think, you know, we need, as we're improving filmmaking, to really look at getting into stories that may be very painful to tell and in some way very embarrassing because people don't talk about certain subjects. We need to take it out of the closet and make things that are essential for some of us, something that other people relate to and will support, because in part, they see themselves in the future as possibly needing or having friends or family members who are going to need, in this case, personal assistance. But I want to say it's the same thing for sign language interpreters. It's the same thing for people who have intellectual disabilities and may need different types of supports or mental health, people with mental health disabilities or whatever. The kinds of supports that we need to live our lives to function in society should be valued, and we should get support from government to pay for that.
Right. And if you are one of those individuals who is in a place in your life where you can go public with that, where you can share your story, please do so, because that's going to empower other people to do the same. When they see your example, they're going to realize they're not alone, and maybe they'll speak out too. Exactly. That's what it's going to take. We got our third question here, live from a friend, Dinah Hobart. Dinah, how are you?
Hi, good. Thank you. Judy, this is awesome. Thank you so much. We were wondering how you were able to sue the New York City Board of Ed, since it was before the 504 and the ADA.
I think we used Article 13.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I got a question here that's just coming in through the chat box. I thought I'd ask it. Judy, we've got folks wondering what you think of the term underlying condition. And is that, as I think it is, code for disability, but people are sometimes afraid or ashamed to say it?
Yeah.
There we go. Other questions from the audience, from the listeners out there? Next, we've got Preston. Preston, give us your question.
Hi. First of all, it's really an honor to meet the both of you. Judy, I've been a big fan of yours since I read Enabling Acts. I work at Bronx Community College in the Disability Services Department. I advise the Students Disability Club, the CUNY Coalition for Students with Disabilities at BCC. Some of my students are here on the call tonight.
Hello.
Based on your challenges and setbacks from early in your career, what advice would you have for my students about how to continue to organize as a community?
I mean, I think interesting question. So I think some of you have come forward wanting to be a part of a club or whatever is going on campus. And for those of you, you see the value of community. You know, you've gotten to a point in your life where you don't want to be squirreled off on the side, not discussing your issues. And, you know, you're really learning how to maneuver through society. Your students, you need to study, you need to get good grades, you need to be looking at what work opportunities you want. You've got all these things going on at the same time. So for me, I think, you know, looking back, first of all, it was very important that my friends on campus, we had no disabled student service office when I started at when we all started at Long Island University. We began to see that there were some other schools that had disability services offices, and we worked together to get a disability services office. So that was very important. And we were discussing issues that I'm sure are still discussed, but were more discussed then because there was no 504, there was no ADA, there were no like rights that disabled people had. If a college professor didn't want to let you use a certain piece of technology in your classroom, you know, you didn't really have a lot of recourse. Now, of course, we've got more recourse. I think it's important that you tell your stories, that you look at ways of helping others feel empowered to tell their stories. And I would also say that one thing that's very important, I believe, is the whole issue of diversity on college campuses has been something which has been exploding for more years now. Disability is still not on the same page with other diverse communities. I think, A, it's important that we as disabled individuals who may be African American or Latino or from the LGBTQI community or Jewish or Muslim or whatever you may be, we need to be able to look to see if we want to be part of some of these other groups. And we need to be working to ensure that these other groups are also integrating disability into the work that they're doing, because we're trying to bring our whole selves forward. And we can't bring our whole selves forward if we're also not getting opportunities and support from other communities. You know, if one feels that you're being discriminated against because of disability, if you're being discriminated against because of sexual orientation or religion or whatever, in many cases, you need to be kind of pulling that together and working with a group of people to really help address those issues. So, you know, on campuses where presidents are putting together diversity plans and diversity committees and on, you know, is disability really being represented? Are people at the table, students and faculty members who have disabilities? When these reports are coming out, are we being appropriately represented? So take opportunities that are relevant, in my view, to what's going on campus to help ensure that disability is being included in the curriculums that are being developed? Is there disability studies in literature? Is disability something that's being integrated, not just into disability studies courses, but in feminist classes, in religious classes, et cetera? How is disability being integrated? So, you know, I think in many ways, the world is our oyster. And look at your college experience as one which enables you to not only learn more academically, but really to take the opportunity to explore areas that you need to explore in order to feel more respected and empowered as disabled people. And in my view, you know, when you leave college, it's, you're just moving into the bigger world. And I hope that disability is something that continues to be a central part of who you are and what you do.
Right, and if you don't see disability represented in any of those places, don't be afraid to interject yourself. Like you did with the 504 sit-ins, occupy it, right?
Yeah.
We've got our last question live here, our last live question from Priya Ray. Priya, are you still with us?
Yeah. Am I there?
We see you.
Go ahead.
I have a grassroots group called DIY Able out of Asheville, North Carolina, and I try to inform people about disability history. So I was actually really excited to see the movie Crip Camp because it's things I've been talking about to people. And now I'm concerned about HR 620. And I'm wondering I'm wondering ways we can unite to fight against it, because of course we're under this administration that was a
law that wanted to roll back some of the advances made with the ADA.
Oh, okay, sorry.
But it hasn't had any action in a little while. It didn't move forward. Yeah.
Right. It did not move into the Senate. And I think your question is important. I'm sorry, I forgot the numbers. But I think, you know, what's important is that, A, we were able to hold it back because the disability community and allies really fought against it. And I think people, you know, for those who don't know it, the purpose of this proposed legislation was to enable, if a disabled person or someone filed a complaint against an entity around lack of accessibility using the ADA, that they would be given additional time to come into compliance. And basically, the community said that no, the law has been around a long enough period of time. They shouldn't be given extra time to do what they need to do. And they were also trying to fend off any kind of litigation, and ADA actually doesn't have litigation in that area. Some states allow it. So, but we can hope in the middle of everything going on, this will not resurface. But if it does, there'll be enough groups to fight against it.
And we should bring out that point out that the ADA has been the law for 30 years. So that should be long enough.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Judy, I want to give you the final word here as we wrap up. You know, you and I really started working together and got to know each other through our work doing disability in media and in disability in media. And a couple of years back, you wrote a report for the Ford Foundation on making a roadmap for inclusion, changing the face of disability in media. I just wanted to say, with your book and the Crip Camp coming out, why is media work so important to you and the work that you're focusing on these days?
Because I believe that representation of disability, of disabled people, while it is improving, is still nowhere where it needs to be. You know, when you talk to teenagers and you ask them if they're seeing themselves in books and TV and streaming on, they typically will say no. And certainly that's true for younger people. And it's true for older people who are acquiring their disabilities. So yes, we should feel good about the fact that there is good work being done by many people. You know, Lawrence, you're doing an amazing amount of work with different groups and writers' rooms and discussions, etc. But the people who have the power and authority around creating media still don't understand its relevance to the broader society. They still believe in too many cases that it's something that won't sell. I mean, when you look at Black Panther as an example, that they learned that in fact there were huge audiences that would come and see Black Panther, not just African American or Black people in the United States, but others. And so I feel like we, especially with this group, with ReelAbilities, we really need to also be much more critical of those who are producing media, whether it's journalism or radio or advertising or documentaries or films, whatever the category may be. We need to be critical when there are obvious areas where disabilities should be included. So if there's going to be work done, for example, on violence against women, not having any mention of disabled people and violence against us as disabled people, or people who acquire disabilities as a result of violence against them. I mean, these are some obvious things. And then of course, I think what the paper also speaks about is we, and ReelAbility again, you know, the central place for these kinds of discussions. We want disability just to be a part of what's happening. It doesn't have to be something about disability. You know, a bartender who has a disability, disabled people in the writer's room, in the whatever. But it's like we need a seat at every table. And in my view, we need more than one seat. We need to make sure that those who are coming together really have a much clearer understanding. I think Crip Camp, my book, and other people's books that are coming out, really, if people study them and read them, can help people understand how it can be done, it should be done, and how it will improve sales.
And, you know, just like Crip Camp shows, right, there are more than one types of disabilities. There are more than one types of seats. Some people have to pull up a chair. Some people bring their own, right?
Exactly.
And we've got to include all of them in order to get something that's representational. Well, Judy, I've got to toss this back over to Yitzi. I just wanted to say thank you. This has been a pleasure, as always. I'm sure we'll be talking more this week. Lots of love. Stay safe there in DC. And to everyone at ReelAbilities, thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for joining us here tonight. Yitzi, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Lawrence. Thank you all so much for being a part of us this week. I want to remind you that the book is called Being Human, spelled like her name, an unrepentant memoir of a disability rights activist. I also want to mention that our next film, our final film, is Bedlam. It's coming on right now. It's only going to be available tonight. It won't be available for the full 24 hours because that's how we had to negotiate the rights in order to allow them to put it on online. I have my son here with me in case you're in the background. I want to give one more thank you to the amazing team here, Yara, Morgan, April, Lola, Sam and Matt, our AV team, Lauren, our cart person, and Brandon, our interpreter. Thank you all so much. A shout out to Victor Calisi, who joined us from the
Hi, Victor.
Abilities. And a big thank you to all of our partners. Please check out our partners page. These are the organizations that make it all happen. Danny Woodburn's here with us tonight. Hey, Danny.
Hello.
So many others. I saw a lot of good friends out there. Christine Bruno, who's still around. Everybody, give a wave. Folks, thank you so much. This has been an inspiring conversation. If you haven't seen Crip Camp yet, tomorrow, save it for after Bedlam. Thank you all, and we look forward to seeing you at more events soon. Have a good night. Stay safe, everyone. Stay safe.